Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I am Pastor Melissa, and what a joy it is to worship with you today. If you'd like to sing along with our hymns today, our lyrics page can be found on our website at franconiaumc.org/lyrics. We invite everyone to join us for coffee and chat on Sundays at 11:30 via Zoom. Again, that link can be found on our church calendar. We hope that you will join us for that time of fellowship. We thank everyone who's been so generous to giving at this time. You can give your offerings by mailing into the church or through our church website. Your giving truly makes a difference in the life of our church and the life of our community. Our Conversations on Race and Faith is meeting Sunday, September 6th at 12:30 via Zoom. That link can, again, be found on our church calendar. These conversations are so important, and we hope that you will join us for them. On Saturday, September 12th, from 5 to 6 p.m., we're having our time of fellowship with our virtual backyard picnic. So you can fire up the grill or pick up some food from your favorite takeout place and log on to Zoom and join us for this time of fellowship and food and just some fun and games as well. Our children's music time will be kicking off for the fall on Monday, starting September 14th, and they're going to be moving to that 4:30 time slot. You can contact Linda Biscardo at our childrensmusic@franconiaumc.org for more information. We also have a new study starting on Monday evenings. We have Moses and the Footsteps of the Reluctant Prophet. This is a series by Adam Hamilton. We're going to be starting on September 14th, 7 p.m. via Zoom. Again, that link is on our church calendar. And now we have some announcements from from Suzanne Ackley with our missions and Joanna Arthur for an update on our staff pastor parish committee.
Good morning. I just wanted to take a minute to tell you about an opportunity that we have here at the church. On October 4th, World Communion Sunday, we will be doing our Rise Against Hunger meal packaging event. It will be drastically scaled down from last year, but we are still going to be having it. We have three shifts, one from 9 to 12 where we'll be setting up, one from 12:15 to 1:30 where we'll be packaging meals, and then 1:30 to 2:45. And some of the times are already fully booked up, but you can check your church email. And I know that we still need a few more volunteers for the 1:30 to 2:45. We can have a maximum of 20 people in order to keep our social distancing. And families or people who live together and therefore can stand close to each other and work are greatly encouraged to sign up. Thank you very much.
Hi, everybody. The SBPRC is pleased to let you know that Kevin Lackie, Director of Music Ministry, has stepped forward to lead our youth ministry on an interim basis until we discern the right permanent replacement. We are beyond blessed that Kevin chose to listen to this nudge to serve in this role. His enthusiasm to organize and nurture our youth, we believe, will be a blessing to them and to the church. Kevin starts this week in this role and will be reaching out to the youth and their families in short order, so look out for an email or a contact from him. We would like to thank Kevin very much for sharing your gifts with us in this role. And finally, we ask that you please continue to pray for us as we continue to work to engage the right people to lead our children and youth. Thank you again, and I'll be here to update you on this process as we make progress. Thank you.
Thank you, Joanna. Good morning. It is my privilege to be stepping into the role of Interim Director of Youth Ministries. You may know me as your music director, rightfully so, but that only begins to scratch the surface of my faith journey. Youth groups have played a part in my life for as long as I can remember. I didn't just learn to play the guitar in church. I learned to play in youth group. Since then, I've been involved in numerous groups, including being the president of mine while an undergrad and running the organization my director's spouse was deployed. Faith is a journey. It's not something you compare to one another, gloat about, or make one feel righteous. It is a personal exploration of who you are and who you're meant to be, while being supported by those around you who are asking the same questions. Youth group is one of the most important support systems a growing person can have on their journey. To our middle and high schoolers, this youth group will be different from anything you've experienced before. It's yours. It's something we're going to build together. Here, you are the most important part. Here, we explore our faith together. To the parents of our youth, this year ahead of us will be ripe with challenges. Your kids will be overwhelmed, and although they don't know it yet, they need a place where they can be grounded in their faith journey. It is your duty to have them be a part of this group. We'll be having a parent informational before our first youth group meeting. Please be on the lookout for an email from the youth director account. I am thrilled for what this year is going to bring, and I am very excited to see our youth together again.
One of the most important things we can do for our own personal development is to know our strengths. God created us with unique abilities that differ from others, but sometimes we struggle to claim them. While we explore our unique strengths, we must also remember that God created us for community, and we use our gifts, our strengths, for the building up of that community, the body of Christ. We live stronger, more fulfilled lives. The Spirit of God is upon us.
We are called to be God's people.
The Spirit of God is upon us.
We are called to be the body of Christ.
Come, let us worship God,
who binds us together in love and service.
Bountiful God, in this time of worship, we have gathered together once again to celebrate your presence among us, to praise you, and to thank you for all you have given us. May this time of worship strengthen and refresh us and fill us with such joy that we can't help but share it with everyone around us. Help us claim our gifts and use them to bring your love to a hurting world. May the transforming spirit of joy and unity bind us together as your body, that we may be your hands and feet and voice in this world, your world. Amen. Today, as we prepare to go back to school, and our kids and teachers to go back to school, we're going to be talking a little bit about blessings and what a blessing is. Now, a blessing is a special prayer that we say asking for God's protection and favor. It's basically a prayer asking for God to be with us during a time and to recognize God's presence that is always there. It can be a prayer also giving thanks for what God has given us. And so you may be familiar that we may say a blessing before our meal prayers, right? And so I'm going to teach you one of those blessings that some of our kids at our church and my family does a lot. It's called the Superman or superhero prayer. And so it goes like this. Thank you, Lord, for giving us food. Thank you, Lord, for giving us food. For our daily bread that we might be fed. Thank you, Lord, for giving us food. Amen. So that's one that you can do at home. It's just a simple prayer, just asking for a blessing for our food and thanking God for that. But most of all, what a blessing does is it helps us to stop and to remember that God is with us in this moment, that God is present, that God never leaves us or forsakes us, that God is here. So that's the important thing as we prepare to go back to school, for you to remember that God is with you, that God is with all of us as we go through the days ahead. And so we're going to do a special blessing right now. The school year looks a little bit different this year, doesn't it? Usually we do a backpack blessing, but because our learning is going to be virtual right now, that we won't have backpacks that we'll carry with us to our schools. But what we do have is we're going to be having our computers and our devices. And so we're going to bless our devices. And so we invite you just to grab your computer right now and to get that computer, and we're going to say a special prayer over our computers. And so at this time, I just invite you to place your hands or over your computer or on the computer, and let us pray. God of all learning, God of all knowing, we bring our computers and other devices to you, Lord. Bless these tools of learning and growing. Use them, we pray, to bless all who use them, to thrive and succeed throughout the school year. Now I just invite all our students and teachers, administrators, school staff, and our parents, if you'll just stand wherever you are right now. Why don't you just open your arms and just kind of place your hands out, just receiving the blessing that God is with us. Let us pray. Gracious God, we lift to you today these students. They stand here ready to receive your blessings. And they commit themselves to study and to learn in the school year ahead. We ask your blessing on each of them and all students. Help them discover and develop the gifts you have given them. As they grow in knowledge, help them also to grow in kindness and compassion, learning respect for themselves and others. Give them strength and perseverance to overcome any obstacles or challenges they face. Bless all who learn and all who guide them. Bless those who teach and counsel and care. We pray for teachers, school staff, and administrators in our schools. Sustain them throughout this school year. Equip them with all the resources and tools that they need, and strengthen their call to teaching and learning. We pray for parents and guardians and all those who care for students. Strengthen them to surround our students with encouragement, support, and love. May they all, students, teachers, school staff, parents, and guardians, remember that you, Lord, are ever beside them. Keep them safe, loved, and healthy throughout this school year. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Ever-present one, you call us to be your presence, your body in this world. But too often we get caught up in being a hand or a foot and lose sight of your overarching mission you set before us. We fracture into pieces, we go our separate ways, forgetting we need each other to be whole. Remind us that we are all members of one body. And if one member suffers, we all suffer. So we pray for those who are sick. Pour out your healing upon them. We pray for those who are in the hospital, those affected by the coronavirus, those suffering from depression and or other mental illness. Comfort those who mourn this day. With your peace that passes all understanding. We pray for an end to racial injustice. And we pray for the people of Kenosha, Portland, Rochester, New York, and Los Angeles. We pray for police officers, for their protection, and government leaders as they seek to protect and to serve and foster needed reform. So that all people are treated fairly and justly. On this Labor Day weekend, we pray for all our essential workers, doctors, nurses, medical staff, researchers, grocery store workers, delivery drivers, government workers, military personnel, postal workers, our teachers and school staff as they go back to school. We thank you, Lord, for all who labor for the good of our community. We pray for those who are unemployed at this time, especially those who have lost jobs during the pandemic. Sustain their families and provide for their needs. We pray for the work of the church. May we be the body of Christ in this place. And may the best evidence of your love be how we live out our faith each day. We ask all this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray as one family. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
The New Testament reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 14 through 20. Indeed, the body does not consist of one member, but many. If the foot would say, "Because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body," that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear would say, "Because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body," that would not make it any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole body were hearing, where would the sense of smell be? But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them, as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many members, yet one body. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
You pray with me. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts and the actions of all our lives be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, perhaps you have heard about this group of animals that once upon a time got together and said that they in order to better themselves, they were going to have a school, start a school for all the animals in the forest. Now, this school offered courses in swimming, running, climbing, and flying. And all the animals were to take classes in each of the areas, which produced some interesting results. Well, the duck was excellent in swimming, but relatively poor in running. So he devoted himself to improving his running through extra practice. Eventually, his web feet got so badly worn that he dropped to only average in swimming. But average was acceptable in the school, so nobody worried about that, except the duck. And the rabbit was a really fast runner, super fast. But no matter how hard he tried and jump, he just couldn't quite get that right takeoff to be able to fly. And he spent so much time trying to do that, his speed really fell off. And he no longer was that fast anymore. And in the climbing class, well, the eagle beat all the others to the top of the tree, but kept insisting on using his own method of getting there. And so this was unacceptable, and so the eagle was disciplined. And then there was the squirrel, who was such an excellent, you know, climber, but the instructor said, you know, you need to spend more time in swim class. You know, you need to spend more time in swim class, squirrel, because you're not an excellent swimmer. And when he first tried it, you know, it wasn't so bad. He jumped in the water, and he was good at jumping, and so he jumped in. But then in the water, his fur got all wet, and then his tail just kept dragging him under the water. And he tried to do the backstroke, but with his little tiny arms, they were so short, and it was hard to do the backstroke. And so he flips over, and then the tail began pulling him under again, and all that fur was just kind of matted down. And then, to make matters worse, he discovers that he's in the class with the otters. And the otters are jumping and diving and gliding and doing all these kinds of river acrobatics. And the squirrel is just this miserable, wet mess of fur trying to learn to swim. Well, the moral of the story is, let rabbits run, let eagles fly, let squirrels climb. We don't want a school of average ducks. But have you ever been a squirrel trying to learn to swim? Have you ever been a squirrel trying to learn to swim? Well, when I was in high school, I put a lot of pressure on myself to be good at everything. And I wasn't, of course, but I worked and worked and worked trying to somehow be. And so despite the fact that I had no real interest in the subject, nor a real aptitude for it, I took not just physics, but AP physics, advanced placement physics, because I had to take the top classes in the school, right? And wow, did I struggle. It felt like to me they were speaking a different language. And so I worked and I worked and I worked. I pulled all-nighters all the time trying to make sure I could get the grades somehow that I expected of myself. And it was so clear that I was a squirrel trying to swim. And because I was focusing so much time on that, I didn't have as much time to do the things that I really loved to do. We are exploring what it means to live out our strengths. And there are times, you know, there's something about this concept, right, of focusing on our strengths that just feels right. It just feels right. It's something that resonates deep within us. That often we're taught that we're supposed to be well-rounded or even good at everything. But in reality, we were not created that way. God has given us all unique and differing gifts and talents and strengths. And we're good at some things, and some things we're just not. And the traditional focus has been for us to work really hard on those weaknesses to bring them up. But God has given us certain strengths that we are being called to use. And when we live out of those strengths, we discover a deeper joy and fulfillment in our lives. And we were blessed, and we bless others as well. This idea of strength comes from the Strength Finder. And in this book, they have developed this book called Living Your Strength. And in the back of the book, there is a code where you can take the Clifton Strength Finder assessment, and it will give you, it will tell you that you have certain strengths that you have. And then you read the book to help you better understand those strengths that you have, and it roots it in a theological perspective. And there are 34 possible strengths that you can get that it describes. And this is a list of those, and they can be categorized into areas of executing, influencing, relationship building, strategic thinking. And as you look through this list and you look at some of those things, you realize that there that different people have different strengths. And you may think of someone that may, you know, you say, oh yes, they have this strength of belief including others, and you can kind of see that lived out. And those strengths, they give us different capabilities to be in the world, different capacities to be able to live in the world. My strengths are in the area of achiever. Surprise, surprise. Maximizer, connectedness, in which that means that I see all things as connected to one another, that we are connected to God and to one another. And so there's that bridge-building capability and to recognize the power of the Holy Spirit that works to empower that. The next one is individualization, which means I believe that each person is given unique and special gifts that we're called to live in the world. That's why this is so exciting to me, you know, as we think about how we use those gifts. And it's exciting to me to be able to see people use those gifts in the church and to live into that. And then strategic. But I have to tell you, I looked at my gifts and I really didn't like them. I'd rather have command or activator, you know, some of those really exciting ones that I saw. And I quickly fell into that trap. Your strengths are better than my strengths, or these are better than these. But when I really started to study them, I really discovered, yeah, you know, this is who I am. And as I've come to better understand how to use my strengths, it's really helped me to live out my call, particularly as a pastor, and to do what I love more successfully. For example, why I think pastors that are church planners are incredible, you know, that's not who I am. I'm also not really a turnaround pastor. I'm not the person that comes in when everything seems to be falling apart and to try to turn things around. But what I'm really good at is coming into a church that's already moving in the right direction. And as we work together to take that next faithful step where God is calling us to take and to kind of take things to that next level. And that's where that maximizer strength, we really see that comes into play. It is important for us to learn our strengths in order to help us to live out who we are in this life, to be who God created us to be. And so last week we started at the beginning, you know, focusing on that foundation that we are loved by God, fully known, and fearfully and wonderfully made. I had someone ask me what fearfully meant here. In the Hebrew context here, it means with a sense of awe, you know, filled with awe. And that's how God sees us when he created us, that we are, God is filled with awe at God's creation. And that we are all created with unique gifts and strengths and talents. But whenever we look at our strengths, we also need to first remember what is most important. We need to know what matters. Because it's not just that God gave me these strengths, gifts, and talents, and God gave you these strengths, gifts, and talents, but we have to remember why. We have to remember why. Because we are not given our strengths in isolation, but in community. And it's not just about us, but all of us. Paul in 1 Corinthians 12, just before our reading today, writes, "Now there are a variety of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are a variety of services, but the same Lord. And there are a variety of activities, but it's the same God who activates all of them in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good." The strengths, the gifts that we are given, you know, are given so that we can fulfill God's purpose. God gives us a wide variety of gifts. You know, some are listed in this chapter of Paul's letter, other in Romans or Ephesians. There are many other gifts that Paul that don't make Paul's list. And all of these gifts are given for the common good. And Paul uses the word activation here. You know, he says it's essential. And now activation is putting your gift your strength into practice for the good of all people. And think about like a credit card that you receive in the mail. And it has that little sticker on it that says, you know, call this 800 number to activate that card. Now, if you wouldn't put that card in your wallet if it hasn't been activated yet, right? Not if you're going to use it. And yet some people receive spiritual gifts, that they have these strengths, but they leave the stickers on and never use them. You know, we don't use our strengths. When we don't use our strengths, the whole community is weakened. Because we need each other. We need each other. Paul reminds us in our scripture today that just as God arranged the parts of the body, so God arranges the members of our communities. All of us having our particular function for the good of the whole. The Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., in his letter from the Birmingham jail, wrote this. He said, "In a real sense, all life is interrelated. All men and women are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. I can never be what I ought to be until you are what you want to be. And you can never be what you ought to be until I am what I ought to be. This is the interrelated structure of reality." In the body of Christ, all of us and the gifts we bring are interrelated. And we can only be successful in our mission of living into God's kingdom when we are working together, when we're truly valuing and depending on the gifts that each disciple offers for the good of the whole. And the ego has no place in this mission. That there's no room for thinking that we and our gifts are better than someone else and their gifts. As we work together for God's mission, no person and no task is less important than the other. We are the body of Christ. And bodies can be united and strong, or they can be broken and weak. Have you ever thought about what it would be like if the members of our physical, you know, bodies behaved like the members of our spiritual bodies sometimes do? So the heart. You know, I'm just stuck in a rut. For all these years, all I do is beat and beat, ba-dum, ba-dum, ba-dum. I am tired of it. It's time for someone else to step up and do this job. Okay, feet, it's up to you. You pump the blood. Or the lungs. We are so underappreciated around here. I don't think the other organs even realize that they couldn't do their jobs without us. If we quit doing our job for a few minutes, everyone will finally see how valuable we are to this place. The brain thinks he's big stuff. Let him see without oxygen for a while, and we'll see how important he is. The liver. Why do I get all the dirty work? You think it's fun making bile? I've been in this body for years now, and do you think anyone has ever asked me to make any decisions, pump any blood, or perform any function that are noticeable outside the body? Sometimes I wonder why I bother. Well, you get the idea. The point is that the individual parts that make up our bodies were created specifically for certain tasks within the body as a whole. The body works as a finely tuned machine when all the parts do what they are uniquely gifted to do. The parts are not jealous of each other and do not covet each other's functions. There are no unimportant parts. Of course, we all have weaknesses that like the appendix, you know, can be a real pain when it gets inflamed, you know, which is why even more important that we cultivate the strengths and serve according to the blessings that God gives us. The gifts and strengths we each possess are not just for us. They are gifts for the whole church, the world, through us. And it's great for us to have these God-given gifts, but those gifts are absolutely meaningless unless we put them to use in the context of the whole body. So Paul's illustration to the Corinthians, we can see certain aspects that ought to exist that as we are the body of Christ for the world. In order to be fully united and functioning, we ought to recognize how connected we are and learn to rely on the gifts and strengths of others, to realize that we need each other. There's no such thing as isolation in the church. We are a community in the deepest sense of the word, bound together by our belief in the power of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and united for a common purpose to share his love with the world. And we are all needed to accomplish this. Sometimes we can get a bit absorbed with our work, and when doing this, sometimes we think our work is of supreme importance, and we begin neglecting or even criticizing others who are working in different ways according to their gifts and their strengths. And when this happens, it really distracts from the greater work that Christ is doing in the world. When it comes to recognizing the interrelated nature of our gifts, we need to come to terms with our own vulnerability and our own dependency. You know, this isn't a popular notion, you know, but people in the church are called to be. We have to accept not only that we need one another, you know, but it's okay that it's good to need each other. It's good to lean on each other and support one another and to share those gifts and talents and skills with one another so that we can allow other people to do the same as well. And the reality is that many parts of the body and the church aren't always functioning as God intends. Those parts that the people often don't realize how this hurts the whole. Not meaning to guilt anyone, and this is not saying that you need to do more. What I am saying in love and honesty is that we need you. We need all of us. God has gifted you in ways that God has not gifted me. And I need to show up and to share my gifts, and I need you to show up and to share your gifts, because without all of our gifts, this church will not function the way God has intended it to function. And that is our goal, isn't it? To function as God intends, to fill the call on our lives and who God creates us to be in the context of community. And of course, that's our goal. And so as a healthy body, we not only realize that we need each other, we also learn to respect each other. And the concept of using the body would not have been unfamiliar to the listeners of Paul's time. Paul didn't invent this image. He didn't invent the use of the concept of talking about the body as a way of understanding how society is to live together. However, Paul did shift the concept. You know, politicians would have used it. Philosophers also would have used this concept. But the way they used it would have been to oppress people, to keep people in their place. Remember that the head is the wealthy and the most important part of the body, and the hands and feet are just there, the lower people in society, just there to do all the dirty work. But Paul changes that concept completely. He says every part of the body is valuable and important, that you need to be, that every part of the body, you know, is important. Paul doesn't say that this one part is stronger than the other. In fact, Paul goes on to point out that even those parts that seem less important, if you didn't have them, we wouldn't be able to see or to hear or whatever. And he says to think about the collective body and how important each and every part is and that is needed. In the body, there are no questions about relative importance. If a limb or an organ ceases to function, the whole body is thrown out of whack. In fact, God has so arranged the body that such even greater honor is given to those seemingly inferior so that there's no division in the body. With great humility, we should offer praise and respect for the gifts others put to service for the kingdom, because each of us is the part of the body has is a great task. You know, and all service ranks with the same with God and ought to be honored and celebrated. And finally, our unity in the body of Christ means that we ought to support one another. If anyone in the body if any one part of the body is affected, all the others are also affected because the whole body suffers with that one part. And so we need to be aware when there's pain in the body, right? And there are members of the body in pain right now. You know, feeling alone and isolated. You're stressed by just trying to figure out how to navigate through how things are right now. Some dealing with illness or our financial need. You know, experiencing loss, racial injustice. There are members of the body in pain. And if you are there right now, I encourage you to send out some signals to reach out. You know, when I stump my toe, right, those pain signals go shooting out throughout my whole body, right? Like, we can feel our whole body when we stump that toe, right? Like, you know, our whole body is affected, and we can feel those pain signals just surge through us. And so if you are hurting right now, if you are in pain, send out some of those signals. Reach out to people so that we know and that we can be there to support you and to help, you know, care for you during this time. Now, we often wonder how we might more fully become the body of Christ. But what we recognize in Paul's writing is that as believers, we are already the body of Christ. And so we should relate to one another in a manner appropriate to who we already are. And we are studying our gifts and our strengths, not so that we can figure out how to more fully be the body of Christ, but so that we can learn how to work together to continue Christ's work in the world. We are the body of Christ. Now we need to act like it. We must realize our need for one another and to treat each other and other members of the body of Christ with respect and compassion. And then as united in a healthy body, we must step out into the world to be the hands and feet of Christ, carry on Christ's work in our time and our place. The Christian band Casting Crowns several years ago had a popular song called If We Are the Body. And the chorus of the song goes like this: if we are the body, why aren't his arms reaching? Why aren't his hands healing? Why aren't his words teaching? And if we are the body, why aren't his feet going? Why is love not showing them there is a way? We are the body of Christ at work in the world today, just as Christ himself was 2,000 years ago. And there's so much work to be done. There are so many people who need to be healed, so many people to teach and to share the love of Christ with. So the question is this: are we going to allow our brains to suffer from lack of oxygen, or are we going to start breathing in air? Are we going to let our limbs rot from lack of blood, or are we going to start our hearts pumping? Or are we going to put our gifts to work, or are we going to expect someone else to get the job done? Or are we going to join together as a cohesive whole born out of mutual need and respect, or are we going to try to do things on our own, doing our own thing? Christ has set as an example, and none of us on our own can even come close to continuing the work that Christ has begun 2,000 years ago. But if we join together in a combined effort, we can be the body of Christ in the world. So we need to know what matters. And we are being called to live into our strengths and our gifts to the best of our ability so that God can work through you and through me, through all of us. So if you are a mouth, speak it. If you are a hand, feel it. If you are feet, walk it. If you are eyes, see it. If you are a heart, beat for it. Whoever you were created to be, whatever gift or strength you have been given, use it and do it and share it. So that together may be fully the body of Christ for the world. So may it be. Thanks be to God. Amen. Thank you for worshiping with us today. Now receive this benediction. You are the body of Christ. You have been called and gifted. Go now in the strength of the Spirit of God to share those strengths with others. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we pray. And all God's people said, Amen.